obsessed with fighting.
I was all about the fight ever since I was a little bitty man.
With a father determined to make a champion.
Champions are truly measured by their tolerance, what they can take, you know what I mean? I laid it on pretty thick.
He would get down his knees and we'd box. Sometimes he beat me, sometimes he let me win.
Roy Jones of Pensacola, Florida.
Well, if he doesn't win the goal off this, then I think there's something rotten in Korea.
He rose to fame after an Olympic fiasco.
The Korean knew he had lost a fight. He didn't want to raise his hand.
It was the worst decision in the history of amateur boxing.
Roy Jones stunned.
He turned pro, only to disappear in a power struggle with the father who trained him.
The relationship they had outside of father-son, which involved the boxer and the coach, I think that put a lot of strain on their personal relationship.
I had to get to be a man, and my father wasn't used to me being a man. My father was used to me being a kid.
We're jumping in here and down the floor. Let's get on the floor with you.
In a sport filled with powerful promoters and dominating personalities, Roy set out alone and made his own rules.
He has had the courage to stand up against powerful promoters who would exploit him.
He wanted to make certain that everyone gave him that respect as far as being an individual in control of his life.
He turned the game upside down.
I don't tonight.
And still won title after title after title.
When Roy gets in the ring, everything slows down. He sees it coming before the guy even throws it.
But critics complained he was all razzle and no rumble.
Some of Roy's fights look like sparring sessions. It's almost as though he's practicing his art.
Roy is a boxer. Roy's not a fighter.
One of the world's greatest boxers fighting to live his life on his own terms.
Somebody about to face Roy Jones Jr.
Nobody's going to be better than me. If they is, they'll kill me to prove it.
This is Roy Jones Jr. Beyond the Glory. November 18th, 1994, Roy Jones Jr. steps into the ring with super middleweight champion James Toney, a fierce competitor, rated one of the best in the sport.
At the time, I beat everybody, Michael Nunn, Iron Barkley, Doug, all the name fighters out there, beat them handily.
In his 5 years as a pro, this was the biggest fight of Roy's career, his first as an underdog. Critics saw the match as a defining moment, the make-or-break event for Roy Jones Jr.
We don't know whether he's a superstar or a fraud.
Roy obliterated James Toney in the ring that night.
Oh! Big left hook, and down goes Toney!
He beat me. Man beat me fair and square, you know. I can't sit here and say, wow, because it's because that. Roy beat me that night fair and square, and I was giving him his props.
Within 30 seconds, you could see the difference. Roy was so much faster. He could hit James at will and go away, and James would never find him. It was a mismatch.
The victory instantly put Roy among the top-ranked fighters in the world. And his father, the man who raised him to be a champion, wasn't there to hear Roy thank him for his efforts.
Oh, all my praise to God. Thank my father and Coach Merck both for the terrific training that they've been doing throughout my entire career.
Father and son hadn't spoken in 3 years. The road to glory had broken them apart.
He didn't understand that I had to have more desire to win than he did for me. And I had to be my own man.
Roy Jr. thinks that Senior may be one of the greatest boxing trainers in history. But they could not exist together professionally.
Roy Sr. grew up in the 1940s and 50s with a love of boxing and a family tradition built around fighting.
Well, I'm from a family of 13. My father always kept a pair of gloves around the house to kind of, you know, kind of keep things squared away between me and my brothers.
As a young man, he went to Vietnam, earned a Bronze Star, and came home to still more fighting. He spent some hard years earning his living as a professional boxer.
My professional career was really a career of bare knuckles, you know, and stuff like that, you know. I just fight, no matter.
But when Roy married Carol Lewis in 1968, he gave up the fights for a more stable life. He hung his punching bags in the garage and would take his firstborn son, Roy Jr., along for his daily workouts.
He was my best friend, I was his best friend, and you know, that's just the way it was. Everything I done, he done.
As his boy grew, he shared his love for the sport of boxing.
I used to get on my knees with him, you know, when he was a little kid, let him swing, you know, and just kind of rough him around a little bit, you know, just father-son play, you know.
He would get down on his knees and we'd box. Sometimes he beat me, sometimes he let me win. But when he beat me, all day next day in school, all I thought about was, how can I get home and win tonight?
Their fascination with fighting didn't stop in the ring. They raised roosters on the farm, fighting cocks they would train and enter in local contests. Sometimes young Roy would watch a bird he'd loved fight to the death.
See a game rooster and know how proud he is, that's what kind of helped me identify with what I was, because they're proud and they stand for what they mean. They'll die for what they mean.
He began training seriously at the age of 6 with his father as coach. The nightly lessons came from the roosters as much as the boxing ring. No bird, no man should enter a fight without total commitment.
The main thing I like about Roos is that he don't fear anything. And he'll go through a lot to get what he wants. So I was taught to be proud like the game Roos is.
I test him, you know, fortitude. I try to make him quit and he'd come right back, you know, and I'd get a little rougher without hurting him. You know, of course, and he'd come right back. And yeah, I seen then that he had it in his heart.
Bonded by boxing, Junior and Senior created their own private world, separate from Roy's mom and his younger brother and sisters.
When they came home, my dad from work and my brother from school, it was maybe an hour for each of them and then off to the gym.
I explained to him that if you started this, you won't be able to quit. I won't allow you to quit, you know, no matter what, you know, I won't allow you to quit. And he decided, and that's what we did, we went to work.
Roy Sr. was relentless, pushing his son to the limits of his strength, his endurance, giving him the tools to become a champion.
The methods and the technique you have to use them to train them is just not something that should be viewed on by the general public, you know, because they would not understand.
My father was hard on me, but I guess he knew I was going to have to be molded to take whatever came at me once I got to be an adult.
Big Roy put his son through drill after drill. He would put him in the ring with boys who were older, taller, heavier, sometimes tying one hand behind his back.
I used to take one hand from him. I used to make him spar guys one-handed. You know what I mean? And when his jab got weak, I took his best hand away from him where he couldn't do nothing but use his jab.
His father wanted him to go through a daily trial by fire to make him into the fighter that he is.
In the ring, Little Roy was brilliant. He destroyed his competition in local and regional fights. He went on to the Nationals, winning a gold medal in the 1984 Junior Olympics. He won Golden Gloves titles 2 years running. His father beamed with pride, even if Roy Jr. never knew it.
You know, our kids, if you get the bragging on a little bit too much, they'll quit.
Roy Sr. wanted his son focused on their next major goal, the biggest prize in amateur boxing, the Olympics.
He was on a mission. Only thing he was concentrating on is winning the gold medal, and so.
Up next, the controversy in South Korea.
I don't know if I'll box to do it ever.
And later, Roy Jr.'s emotional struggle to become his own man.
I just want to make my own place. A lot of times, fathers forget that.
Since the age of 6, Roy Jones Jr. had been under the intense training regimen of his father, Roy Sr. He'd become a virtual fighting machine, on track to become a champion.
I had love for winning. And to have that kind of love for winning is good because you have to have a love for winning to be a winner.
He worked hard. I know because I put him through it. You know? He's been under pressure that some of the training methods and techniques you can't imagine.
Armed with his father's lessons, Roy became a junior national champion. He was a budding celebrity in his hometown of Pensacola and a mentor to aspiring local boxers like Derek Smoke Gaynor.
He always came and got me and sat me down. You have to do this, or you're going to be in jail, or you're going to be dead.
He was always a role model. I think people looked to him because he was so different from everyone else in the community or in the neighborhood.
He had talent, maturity, and incredible ability when the Olympic trials were held in 1988. there was little doubt Roy Jones Jr. would make the cut.
What I was impressed with more than anything, he was very decisive. You know, and he knew where he wanted to go and how he wanted to get there.
He was just 19 years old, the youngest member of the 1988 United States Olympic boxing team. Roy arrived in Seoul wanting and expecting to go all the way. The years of training with his father had given him the kind of preparation few fighters could match.
He was there on a mission. The only thing he was concentrating on is winning the gold medal.
An Olympic gold medal was a childhood holy grail for him. That was something that he had been coached to do. It was his birthright.
He blazed his way through the early fights, never losing even a round, as his friends and family watched from home in Pensacola.
We had signs all over town, and we knew that he would go there and win gold medal.
It was all a big hoopla, so I think I realized that, you know, this was something major here.
Roy's dad was there with him in South Korea and watched from the stands as Roy entered the ring for the gold medal round.
Roy Jones, the 19-year-old from Pensacola, Florida.
He was facing a local hero, a South Korean fighter named Park Si-hun.
Jones belly up, points, peppering him with multiple punches. There's one.
He was counting the guy. He was frustrating the guy, moving around the ring. When he's turning, he would catch him with good shots.
Park Si-hun is taking a thrashing.
Just hurt him with a lot of hooks.
And should be 15 seconds away from the goal.
He was in the zone.
It is all over. Roy Jones.
Everybody was saying, well, we got another goal.
I look in my corner, I see the people. They had a council table where they look at the scorecards first, and the Koreans start jumping up and down. The referee was like, I can't believe they're doing this to you. And he said it under his breath because he's not supposed to really be talking.
In the blue corner.
Although Roy outscored his opponent in every round, the judges gave the fight to Park Si-hun on a vote of 3-2.
And that is very difficult to figure.
When it happened, it was kind of a shocker, you know what I mean? Really, I was kind of dismayed. Like, I was without thought, you know what I mean?
Even the winner seemed astonished by the decision.
The Korean knew he had lost the fight. He didn't want to raise his hand when they actually made the decision. But then he picked Roy up, and Roy, like, was just put me down.
I had a translator to ask the guy right off, didn't think he wanted to fight. She asked him. He said, no, I didn't know.
I think this is the greatest robbery I've seen since the Great Train Robbery.
There have been thousands of horrible decisions in amateur boxing, but given the circumstances, the nature of the exposure, the fighter who was involved, the way the boxing competition had gone at those Olympics, it was the worst decision in the history of amateur boxing.
Roy left the ring covering his face with a towel to hide his tears.
He didn't want anyone to see him cry. He was too much of a tough guy for that. So when he put that towel over his face, it was just really crushing.
Everything I had sacrificed and worked so hard for, I missed a lot of stuff to get to that point. And it's like when you get to that point, they still robbed. You know what I mean? It's like that was a very crushing blow to me. That was like the worst day of my life so far.
Fans were outraged by the obvious injustice of the decision. As consolation, Roy was named the outstanding boxer of the Olympic Games. In an impressive display of goodwill, 50 Korean monks arrived to personally express their shame and sorrow.
And they would come up and just tell me that they were so sorry what happened to me, what their country did to me.
An investigation later found the three judges who voted against Roy had been wined and dined by Korean officials. Two were banned from judging for life. But even if the world agreed that Roy had won the fight, the record books would always show that he had been second best. He considered giving up the sport he'd loved all his life.
I don't know if I'll box again ever.
He said he would never box again, and I thought his whole world came down, so it's like my whole world came down.
Roy grieved, and the father who had pushed him so hard to be a winner, this time consoled him in his devastating loss.
It was different than any other time. He used to try to tell me, you know, not to stop crying. He was like, don't worry about it. You got more heart than 90% of people that you ever seen in your life, so don't worry about it.
It really disturbed him. I knew it. And it even made me more madder for him, you know. I was really disappointed, and I was hurt for him, you know.
It was a rare moment of tenderness between this hard-driven father and son. It would be among their last for many years to come. Up next, a big dog bites a little girl, and a father and son break apart.
Roy's father took a gun and went over and killed the dog.
It was like God gave me a plain vision. You can sit right here, and you're gonna die.
And later, Roy is branded a reluctant warrior, dazzling but distant in the ring.
It's like watching the Yankees take batting practice.
Roy is a boxer. Roy is not a fighter. Roy will not fight unless he gets in a confrontation where he has to fight.
You're watching Roy Jones Jr., Beyond the Glory. After his controversial loss in the 1988 Olympics, Roy Jones Jr. was stunned to arrive home in Pensacola to a hero's welcome. The international debate over his silver medal had made him more famous, more beloved, than winning the gold ever could have.
I think the whole city was at the airport waiting on him. The whole city. It was like unbelievable.
Everyone had signs. We just wanted to make him feel good and make him happy.
Everywhere he went, they was giving him gold medals. Not just his town, the whole country. I think that's what kind of helped him, you know, come out of it.
Seeing the impact he'd had on other people's lives, Roy abandoned his thoughts of quitting the sport.
If I quit, how in the hell am I ever gonna get up in front of a group of people and tell them, if you get knocked down in life, get back up, keep going even stronger? You can't say that you don't quit when you got knocked down. Can you? And I was like, dang. And I knew at that point, whether I wanted to or not, I was gonna start back fighting.
Well, he really thought about everything that he was teaching me and showing me about no matter what, you have to continue to go on. Once he got back and had a chance to sit still and he thought about it, he said there's no way he's gonna let us down.
With his leadership and strength in the face of adversity, Roy had proved his maturity. 6 months later, he decided to turn pro. In the boxing world, Roy Jones became front page news. He was soon flooded with management offers from the biggest names in the sport. In the end, Roy and his dad decided to maintain their independence and keep the business in the family. Roy Sr. became coach, trainer, manager, and promoter, but it was a mistake from the start. Roy Jr. was a grown man who felt his father was still running his life.
I think at first he thought I was trying to take his identity or trade places with him. I wasn't trying to trade places, I just wanted to make my own place. And a lot of times fathers forget that.
Roy Sr. made a plan for his son's career. He started him off slowly, hoping to build excitement and anticipation for his entry into prize fighting. But 3 years went by, and Roy was still fighting unknowns in obscure venues.
I thought we should have moved much, much faster. We spent 2 or 3 years fighting bums at the Pensacola Fairgrounds and losing our butt just putting on the shows.
Roy talked to his father. He wanted bigger fights against better opponents. He wanted a championship, but communication was breaking down and his frustration was growing.
You could tell he was dealing with a lot of different things, but he dealt with them within himself. He didn't explain to my mom. He didn't tell me about them.
Roy Sr. ignored the growing tension. He was sticking to his plan.
I can remember getting a call offering Roy a championship fight about 2 or 3 years into his career, and I called his father, and his father said no. He said, Roy doesn't want it. I didn't know till years later he never even mentioned that to Roy.
He didn't realize that he was stepping too far on me because he was about to smother me, and I had to move out from under that.
The pressure exploded on a hot day in June 1992. One of Roy Jr.'s dogs bit his little sister on the arm.
Roy's father took a gun and went over and killed the dog. And Roy came home and got very, very upset.
Killing the dog was the final straw and pushed Roy to the decision he'd always known one day he'd have to make.
It was like God gave me a plain vision. You can go be you and see how high your blaze can burn, or your how high your flame can go, or you can sit right here and you're gonna die.
their mistakes was made, but for me to say I would have done them any different, that might change the outcome of things a little bit, you know what I mean?
After the split, Roy called on his Olympic coach, Alton Merkerson.
He said, I want you to work my next fight. First thing came out of my mouth, I said, what's the problem? So I knew at that time he had made his mind up, and I knew something was seriously wrong.
His father came in the next morning and said, I want you to know, Roy and I have broken up.
I had to keep a fire lit in myself to let myself know, look, you by yourself now. Either you gonna do or die. You just like one of them game chickens. And you either go over there and go kill something, or something gonna kill you.
Roy took control and vowed to hold on to it. He refused to hire a promoter. He refused to play the game of boxing the way it had always been played.
Everybody said I couldn't do. You can't possibly get to be world champion without being affiliated with some of the top promoters, so you're not gonna make it.
Roy founded his own promotional arm called the Square Ring. Less than a year later, he was in his first title fight, challenging Bernard Hopkins for the middleweight crown.
Let's get ready to rumble!
Roy had broken his right hand before the fight and called on the tough training of his father to pull him through.
If Jones fights the way I think he's going to fight, he's going to be well on his way to superstardom.
He dedicated the fight to his dad as he fought the bout with one good hand.
I said, Roy, you don't have to take this fight. We can postpone it.
No one knew he was fighting in excruciating pain. Not the press, not his opponent.
Fight, I was like, this is my big moment. I'm one-handed, but I still got a shot. And I hit him with confidence. Bam, bam, bam. And people don't realize you go through that kind of pain, but I had to.
Now, the IBF middleweight champion of the world, Roy
Nearly 5 years after the Olympic fiasco, Roy Jones Jr. finally held a professional title.
Electrifying. The gleam in his eyes, the gleam in my eyes, the whole camp was just, you know, we've got a world title. We've got a world title. I mean, we're on the road now.
I was just very happy to get the pressure of becoming a world champion off my back.
After the fight, Roy told reporters he'd lay the belt at the feet of the man who made it possible, his father. But Roy Sr. refused to see him.
I love him, but he is the most stubborn person that ever lived.
Roy Jr., he made several attempts to make amends with my father, but my father wasn't really open to it because they had different views on what happened.
In 1995, Roy Jr. beat the undefeated James Toney for the super middleweight crown. It was his second title in two weight divisions in less than 2 years. Skeptics had become believers. Roy was rated pound for pound the best boxer in the world.
He's Miles Davis. He's Picasso. Roy is just naturally gifted with instincts, reactions, abilities that other fighters don't have and will never have.
Roy had captivated the boxing world with his power, his speed, the distinctive style he learned from his father, and his fighting roosters.
He's really full of self-confidence.
Roy is an animal. Matter of fact, the move that he used on Tony when he fought him, when he did like this, and Tony mimicked him, and he caught him with all those hooks. That's a chicken move.
Roy had become the champion his father had trained him to be. He lived the dream they'd shared all his life. But even 3 years after their bitter split, there was no common ground. The family was torn apart. Up next, the fearsome power of Roy Jones Jr. A champion avenges his only loss in the ring.
That night he didn't smile. He got in there, he went right at Montel.
You're watching Roy Jones Jr. Beyond the Glory. Roy Jones split with his father to gain complete control of his career. Inside the ring, he was always in charge, dazzling opponents with his power and speed.
It is over! Roy Jones Jr.!
When Roy gets in the ring, everything slows down. He sees it coming before the guy even throws it.
Critics began to complain that his remarkable control resembled caution, that Roy Jones Jr. exposed himself just enough to win his fights.
Some of Roy's fights look like sparring sessions because the difference in talent is so obvious, and yet Roy doesn't seem to want to maximize that difference and take it through to the obvious conclusion of a quick finish.
It's almost as though he's practicing his art.
Roy is a boxer. Roy's not a fighter. Roy will not fight unless he gets in a confrontation where he has to fight. And that's being smart.
And then he saw me reluctant warrior, this and that and other. It's just that I got a little bit more sense.
To Roy, the point of the fight was to win. And even coasting, he was undefeated and seemed undefeatable.
Roy's in a situation where he's so much better than the people in his weight class, so it's not fair to him for people not to give him his just due.
I really feel that he came into boxing at a bad era. I mean, I just think it's really, he makes these guys, these are great fighters, but he makes them look like they're nothing.
In the history of boxing, great fighters have always had great rivals. Ali had Frazier, Leonard had Duran. The lack of a true challenge to Roy Jones Jr. was leaving fight fans cold. His pay-per-view events generated only modest sales.
I quickly got out opponents that people look at for the big name. And I don't have the opponents that other people have.
There is no such thing as not having an opponent. Part of being a good promoter is to find opponents, to build up opponents. He insisted on doing his own promotion, and that was a mistake.
I remember telling him, I knew we could get a lot more money if we would tie in to this promoter or that promoter. He wanted to maintain his independence.
Roy ignored his critics and his advisors and continued his efforts at self-promotion. He played point guard in a U.S. Basketball League game one afternoon and defended his title later that night.
Roy thinks he'll make his Eric Lucas fight more interesting to the public by playing basketball the morning of the fight. Well, of course, he makes the fight less interesting to the public because the statement he makes is that this fight is so easy that I can play basketball on the morning of the fight and I'm still not worried about losing.
In the fall of 96, he moved up another weight class to light heavyweight and again easily won the title. But the next fight would blindside him. Roy entered the ring against Montel Griffin expecting his usual fight, controlled, confident, wearing down his opponent before finishing him off in the later rounds.
I want a good, clean fight.
But Griffin disrupted his plan, putting him off balance with his strange and awkward style.
It was interesting, because it was the most frustrated we've ever seen Roy in the ring.
Don't work in this corner. Get him back. Get his back, too.
It took 9 rounds, but Roy finally had Montel against the ropes. And when it seemed he was going down, Roy kept punching.
And Griffin's knee goes down, and Jones lands 2 punches after Griffin's knee was on the canvas.
Roy Jones is going to be disqualified.
The referee disqualifies the red corner.
I know he went to his knee, but I didn't know if he was on his knee for sure or what. I ain't got time to stop and say, well, let me look and see if he's on his knee. I got to do what I got to do.
You can't be in the middle of jumping off a bridge, and once you leave the bridge, say, oh, I don't want to jump. I want to go back up.
The impossible had happened. Roy was disqualified and took the first loss of his professional career. Griffin gloated in his victory by default.
I was taking it to him. I was making a miss. I was catching with a jab. His face was all swollen up. And I thought he was winning, feeling fair square.
That was very childish for him to do that because all it does is take me to a place you don't want to go.
The only one calm in the dressing room was Roy. And he turned to me. He said, get me the rematch. I said, what do we... He said, I don't care what it costs. Get me the rematch.
In the rematch 5 months later, Roy gave the fans what they'd been waiting for. There was no artful pretense, no holding back. It was pure cockfight, a battle to the death, and Montel Griffin's bravado was going down.
It was, boom, here's my left hook, now you want to taste it again? And Griffin reeled all the way across the ring on that one big shot.
The fight was over in the first round. Roy had once again proven his power and dominance.
That's that. Jones gets his vindication via a first-round knockout. And he finishes off Griffin with a half hook, half uppercut that landed on the butt.
The best fight in the world, come from I Talk Tonight.
It was a brief, cruel, vicious reminder to us of what Roy can do when he's really motivated to do something. A lot of the boxing world said, why can't we see that every time? And that gets back into the complex personality of Roy Jones.
But Roy had made his point. He had power when he needed it, control when he wanted it. He was undeniably his own man. He reached out again to his father to forge a new relationship on more equal terms. But Roy Jr. was rebuffed again.
My father never wanted to know what he was doing, how he was progressing. He didn't want to know any of the details of his boxing career.
I was there, but I wasn't physically there, you know what I mean? So I just kind of stepped back and watched it happen. If that went the wrong way, you'd have seen me. You had to work on that.
Up next, a boxing heavyweight sparks a father and son reunion.
His father would not let him fight Buster Douglas. It's just too much mass, you know what I mean? I just wouldn't run a Volkswagen into a Big Mac truck. It's just that simple.
You're watching Roy Jones Jr., Beyond the Glory. After redeeming himself against Montel Griffin,
Jones gets his vindication via a first-round knockout.
Roy Jones Jr. ruled the light heavyweight division.
People don't realize he's really a 168-pounder, but he's fighting these big guys at 175. These guys are 6'2". And they walk around at 200 pounds.
Virgil Hill was a legitimate big man with a long reach and a deadly jab.
I fainted, I touched him with the hook up top, and I rushed the body shot down to the right.
So far, it's Jones's power over Hill's jab.
Boom! Right to the body, down
the
third off.
The shot sound like a .22 rifle going on.
Hill's jab.
Boom!
I think that was the hardest body shot I've saw thrown throughout my whole coaching and boxing career.
He's holding the kidney area on the right side.
Find out later that he did break a rib.
Even men bigger and stronger than Roy were no match for him. And the one-time middleweight considered taking on the ultimate opponent in prize fighting, a true heavyweight.
I was very strong going to fight Buster Douglas because I had heard from Douglas's camp, some people there that he was just a shell of himself.
In the winter of 98, a promoter came up with $6 million for a match between Roy and the now fading former champion Buster Douglas. Despite nearly 6 years of almost total silence, Roy Sr. came forward.
His father would not let him fight Buster Douglas. The thing I know about Roy is, if he get hurt, he won't quit. They have to kill him, you know what I mean? Not saying that he can't whoop him. There's just too much mass, you know what I mean? I just wouldn't run a Volkswagen into a Big Mac truck.
At his father's urging, Roy pulled out of the negotiations, and they began a slow, cautious reconciliation.
When they kind of first got back into it, you know, they just didn't come right out like, hey, Dad, I love you, sorry, that kind of thing. It was like, oh, how are the chickens?
When we get older, we get to the point where we learn to accept the fact that, you know, we screwed up. We done something wrong, you know what I mean? But still, you have to look at it like there's a reason for everything.
Defense last 20 seconds.
All the pressure that my dad did put on me when I was a kid only made me grow closer to God because I knew that only God could get me through that and make me to be what I am today.
During the long years of estrangement from his father, Roy Jones Jr. had become a father himself.
While they ain't around, they seem to find a reason. I know some.
He has a set of twin boys and a third son, a toddler.
No matter what.
Parenthood is a tough thing, is what people don't realize. And a lot of times you don't realize how tough it is until you get in that position yourself.
Roy has regular visits with his youngest, Roy Jones III, and gained custody of the twins in 1999 when they were 7 years old.
Hey, my youngest son and my set of twins, we're the best of friends. We just go out and hang together.
Take my boys to do stuff, teach them how to fish, teach them how to hunt, teach them ways of survival so in case something happens to me, knowing that they're going to be all right because they know how to survive, because that was passed down to me from my dad and I passed it on down to them.
What if your eyes feel me?
Roy spends as much time with his kids as he can, sharing music together, playing games and sports, everything but boxing. Roy's determined not to repeat the mistakes of the past.
He's done a great as father, and I think he's going to even get better, but he might end up being a better father than I would. But that's the way it's supposed to be.
Do a better job with mine than my father did with me, and mine can probably do a better job with them than I'd be able to do with them. So as long as we constantly get better, then I think it's all good.
Despite all his great success, Roy is haunted by the brutality he's seen in the sport of boxing. He sat at ringside as an expert commentator as junior lightweight Jimmy Garcia received a lethal beating. And he was devastated by his own bout against Vinny Pazienza, a fighter who had just come back to boxing after suffering a broken neck.
So I was afraid he might get re-injured and mess his neck up and may kill him. But I was very afraid. I don't want to kill him, buddy.
Roy is working to help guarantee that all boxers have the kind of autonomy and protection he and his fighters enjoy.
Ladies and gentlemen, Muhammad Ali and Pensacola's own Roy Jones Jr.
He joined with the legendary Muhammad Ali in support of legislation that helped clean up the boxing industry.
Now, how many guys you hear get killed playing baseball? How many even you hear get killed playing basketball? But boxing, you hear about guys getting killed. That's the toughest sport out still right now today. And they're one of the lowest paid sports right now. And I just don't think that's really fair.
Meanwhile, Roy is still waiting for a worthy competitor to challenge his crown. And if someone steps forward, there could be no doubt that the terms of such a meeting would be set by Roy Jones Jr.
I did it my way. You know, I came in this thing free, and I'm gonna leave out this thing free. You know, I came in, did it just like everybody said I couldn't do. So you're not gonna make it.